Most interesting causal relationships involve the interaction of multiple variables to bring about a given effect. In these sorts of instances, comparing different cases isn't going to be very helpful in finding cause-effect relationships. To see why, consider the example of whether high sugar consumption causes diabetes. I'm sure we all know plenty of people who consume large amounts of sugar, but who nevertheless don't have the disease. This shows that high sugar consumption is not sufficient to cause diabetes. By the same token, there are plenty of people out there who don't consume large amounts of sugar, but who nevertheless have diabetes. This shows that high sugar consumption is also not necessary to cause diabetes. And yet we know that high sugar consumption is an important contributing factor to contracting the disease. To be able to account for these sorts of cases, we need to introduce a new wrinkle into our study of Mills methods. In particular, we're going to now look at the statistical application of the methods. The big difference here is that instead of looking at individual cases, we're going to be comparing groups. So that's what the statistical application of the methods means. It has nothing to do with whether statistics are actually involved in the examples. So here's how this works. We're going to be comparing groups, and we want to make sure that the groups differ with respect to the independent variable that we're testing. Next, we want to make sure that the groups are statistically similar with respect to any other independent variables. Next, we look to see whether the groups are statistically significantly different with respect to the effect. If they are, then we have some evidence to show that the independent variable that we're testing for causally contributes to bringing about the effect. If there is no statistically significant difference between the groups, then that suggests that the independent variable we're testing for, in fact, does not contribute causally to the effect. Let's look at a couple of examples of how this works. So here we have a table showing the statistical use of the method of difference. We have two groups, and the question that we're considering is whether listening to heavy metal music contributes to the committing of crimes. The first group is comprised of people who listen to heavy metal music. The second group is comprised of people who do not. Now notice that we want to make sure that the groups are statistically similar with respect to age distribution and gender distribution and any other variables that we might think have some influence on whether people commit crimes. Over in the right-hand column, we see that roughly 2% of the people in group 1 have committed crimes. By comparison, only 1.8% of people who do not listen to heavy metal music have committed a crime. Now, is that statistically significant? Well, it depends. Statisticians have very sophisticated methods to test for statistical significance. We're really not in a position to answer that right now. But if it is statistically significant, then we have some evidence that listening to heavy metal music does in fact cause people to commit crimes. The next example that we're going to consider concerns the statistical use of the method of concomitant variations. The question being examined here is whether spending more and more hours per day on the internet increases people's reported levels of stress. To make things easy, I've broken people into three groups. In group one, we have people who spend 0 to 2 hours per day on the internet. Group two is 2 to 5 hours, and group three is 5+ hours. Again, we want to make sure that the groups are statistically similar with respect to age distribution and gender distribution and so on. Over in the right-hand column, we have a reported stress level on a scale of 1 to 10. Group 1, their average stress level is 3, group 2 is 4, and group 3 is 7. Now again, we don't have the sophistication here to determine whether the difference between, say, group 2 and group 3 is statistically significant, but there's pretty good reason to think it probably is. So then what about the difference between group 1 and 2? Well, group 2 does report a stress level that is 33% higher than those in group 1. So that might very well be statistically significant. Now remember that the statistical use of Mills methods only apply to the methods of difference and concomitant variations. If we have groups that are similar with respect to the independent variable that we're testing, then really we don't have different groups at all. That's why the method of agreement simply doesn't apply here. And if the method of agreement doesn't apply, then neither does the joint method. One last thing. We have some important terminology from this section that we want to remember. First of all, we have the notion of an observational study. Remember that we can't always test causal relationships within a laboratory. Sometimes it's not practical, other times it's not ethical. So we have to go out and observe things that are actually happening in the world. The second term to remember is that of statistical significance. To say that there is a statistically significant difference between two groups means that there's less than a 5% chance that the difference between them is due to chance. And finally, we have the notion of a proxy variable. Sometimes we want to talk about whether certain independent variables bring about an effect like increased health. Well, health is pretty abstract, so we want to pick some other variable that stands in for health. For example, lower blood pressure, or lower cholesterol level, or perhaps even longevity. In these cases, lower blood pressure, lower cholesterol level, and so on are proxies for good health. As you become more familiar with Mill's methods, you'll discover that in fact most scientific studies out there involve the statistical use of the methods. That's why it's important that we be able to recognize them and their application.